be gracious to us and bless us,
and make his face shine on us,
so that his ways may be known on earth.
His salvation among all nations.
May the people praise you, God.
May all people praise you.
May the nations be glad and sing for joy.
For you rule the people with grace.
May the people praise you, God.
May all people praise you.
May God bless us,
so that all the ends of the earth will hear of his love.
Stand as we sing in the garden.
chapter 41, verses 10 through 13. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. All who rage against you will surely be ashamed and disgraced. Those who oppose you will be as nothing and perish. Though you search for your enemies, you will not find them. Those who wage war against you will be as nothing at all. For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you.
Welcome any Do we have any first-time visitors?
I see one here.
I see one.
You don't have to stand, but well, if you want to stand, you can stand. We have a little gift for you. And in that gift bag, there's a mug. And on that mug is a picture of the Mayflower we traced our roots. So thank you so much for joining us. Thank you. Church, and you may or may not know. The Congregationalists were noted for many firsts in American history. They founded Harvard in 1636 as the first American college. Other universities started by the Congregationalists included Yale, Dartmouth, Amherst, and Oberlin. They were the first American church to send missionaries to a foreign country. They were instrumental in the Underground Railroad prior to Civil War, and they were among the first to come to the South in a time of Reconstruction. So, did you learn something this morning?
I did.
A couple more announcements in our life as a church. Ladies' Lunch is this Wednesday, so if you haven't signed up, please do so in the hall next door. It is this Wednesday at 11:30, and our speakers will be from the Guadalupe Center. Very, very interesting and certainly worthy place. The youth car wash is next Saturday, so let's not pray for rain, but get your cars dirty this week and bring them out to the church next Saturday. Spaghetti dinner, another fundraiser for our youth who are saving money to go to the conference this summer, which will be Wednesday, October 18th. And there's also a sign-up sheet to help us with the trick or treat trunk.
Trunk or treat.
Yeah,
no tricks at church. No
tricks. Trunk or treat. Okay, so we need some helpers and volunteers. So please do sign up next door.
Just a couple other things. As fall is ramping up, there's so many exciting things happening here at the church. This Monday, we are restarting Monday morning men. We took a break for the summer, but we are kicking back up this Monday morning at 8 a.m. I'll be there. I'll lead a devotional. We'll eat some breakfast. And then we'll just kind of talk about what direction y'all want to take it from here. So I hope you can join us on Monday morning. Also, you heard about this last month. Our parish nurse program is kicking off today. We will have several nurses available to you after the service. Right next door, to your left over here, I guess to my left, to your right, over here in the office buildings. If you would like to go over there with them, ask them any kind of questions. You can get your blood pressure checked. If you have questions about medication, they are there as an informational service to you completely free of charge. So that's right after the service and right next door. We want to take a special moment out of the service here. Several weeks ago, when Irma was on her way here, we had several people contact the church and express some concerns because they did not feel like they had a safe place to go. Were we having more? Oh, okay. I don't even know. I don't know what that number said. Even when you're acting pastor for the week, didn't you hear things? We'll roll with it. I don't know. We are going to have a few people come forward. Barbara and Jim and Tara, go ahead and head on up. We are going to let you speak this morning kind of about your experience, you haven't come already, about during the hurricane. And then also, while we're talking, if we want to go to the next slide, Juan Alvarez, who kind of coordinated the shelter and spent his time here, also created this wonderful work of art and inspiration of their time here, shows the hurricane coming in, that yet the church remaining a place of life. So, Tara, Barbara, if y'all want to share a little bit about your experience, what led you to the church, what that weekend here at the church, whether the hurricane was like, go ahead.
Well, first of all, I have, Chuck and I have very dear friends that I got a phone call in the morning saying that they were to be evacuated from their home. And I said, oh my gosh, Jean, I just got an email from the church. And they said that any of the members of the church that need a place to go to for safety, you're welcome to come. So I ran right over here and I ran into Stacy and I said, is it true? And she said, Barbara, it is true. And I said, I have friends that are not members here. And she said, they're welcome as well. To this day, they cannot thank First Congregational Church for the safety that they gave them, because this friend of ours, who's a retired cardiologist, is now suffering from ALS, and he's in a 450-pound wheelchair, and I would not be surprised if they actually joined this church. The other thing that I would like to say is during this 2.5 days, I got to finally meet Tara in person and her mother, and they entertained us so nicely with her guitar, and Vaughn did a fabulous job of keeping us all in line and playing the Vaughn over the And to Pat, you do an incredible job keeping us all eating and organized, and everybody worked together, and everybody helped drag food and everything over into the sanctuary, and it's a memory that Chuck and I will never forget.
This sanctuary was absolutely peaceful. It sounded just like it does right now. And that's what it was like in the category, whatever that was, blowing outside of the window. So it was amazing. Other than the water that was gushing in under the storm, we had some very, very brave souls. I know that Sean went out and shoveled some rock chips in front of the doorway because we had, you know, water coming in just under the doors because the water was rising. I know that Juan had an escape plan for us, whether we had to go out the doors or out the roof, and we had our arms around for a helicopter. So he did a great job. Everybody just worked together. It was so beautiful. It was such a common and beautiful place to be and just welcome so many people and just to see everybody jump in and do their part. And we all kept our spirits really up. It was just such a great, I had a great hurricane. I had a blast. So.
Carlos, come back next weekend. You'll see another sleep over it.
It was really fun. So thank you. And thanks to everybody who had a part. And thank you for opening the sanctuary to us. And also, you know, for being pet friendly, which was really, really huge because a lot of us had. You know, we were all very respectful, so but that was just such a great day. So thank you so much. Thank you guys.
Center is a special place. This center, as you risen to the occasion and decided to keep their patients within the facility, although many other nursing homes and facilities sent their patients home. I was informed by my brother that the main generator has collapsed. They are now using a lower capacity generator, and it is not powerful enough for all of their patients. I am planning to coordinate with Home Depot for Miami to purchase and deliver a generator to Puerto Rico. Now, this was sent by 1 hour. Is in that facility. So I please ask you to please contribute this week, or if you don't have money with you this week, next week. It's very important, and it's our outreach to our friend and you. Thank you. I'm going to name them out to the First Congregational Church, and then the Congregational Church will name them out to one so we can get the facilities. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Let's have one more prayer this morning. We'll bring the offering around right after the message. And yes, please feel free at that time when you need to fill out your envelope, et cetera. Let's have one more prayer today as we transition into our message for this morning. God, we thank you for this opportunity to be here today. God, we thank you for the stories of protection and safety. But God, we realize that it's not a universal story, and we pray that those you have blessed would be a blessing to others. God, I pray as we did before that you would help us enter into a heart and a time of worship as we open up your scripture and see what you have for us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, it is so good to be here with you today, to be preaching. It's been a few weeks since I've had the opportunity to do the message. We were closed for a couple of weeks with the hurricane. And Les, this week, he is on a three-week cruise down going through Panama. And I've got a lot of positive feedback from a sermon series that we did back in the summer called Don't Waste Your Life. It was 3 weeks long. Each week we looked at a new story, a new statement that was all evolved around this current theme. So we decided with these next 3 weeks to do the same thing. We're going to do another 3-week series, and we've entitled it Fearless, which I'm really looking forward to this series, this message, this whole time in our life as a church. As Pam alluded to, and as we talked about, it's finally fall, and it feels so good to be there. Fall is one of my favorite times of the year. Football is in full swing, NFL, college, and also in the fall, specifically in October, we are leading up to one of my favorite holidays, which is Halloween. I love Halloween. I've loved it since I was a kid. Probably since I was chubby and I liked to eat candy. And there's no other time of the year where you get as much candy as you do on Halloween. I love Halloween. I love scary movies. I like seeing little kids running around in costumes. I actually get excited to see trick-or-treaters. And I've already told Caitlin that once we buy a house, I am going all out with the Halloween decorations. Some people like to do the lights at Christmas and the deer. I want my house at Halloween to be terrifying. I mean, we're not gonna have like these plastic spiders, these smiling pumpkins. Like, I want my house to be the house that keeps little kids from going to sleep. And I want my house to be that house. And then, if they can summon up the courage to get all the way to the door on Halloween, I'm just going to give them like 8 bars of candy apiece. I just love Halloween. Like I said, I like horror movies, and I just like all about it. So I thought that this would be a good time of the year, being fall, being leading up to Halloween, to talk about living a fearless life. Because fear is very popular in the Bible. It's a very common topic. When a lawyer comes to Jesus and he says, "What is the greatest commandment?" Jesus essentially says, "You need to love God and you need to love people." But did you know that the most repeated commandment in all of the Bible is do not be afraid? Four small words that come up in the Bible more than 70 times. Do not be afraid. Several years ago, I was living in Houston, and I came to church one morning, and the topic of the message, I saw the title, and it said, do not be afraid. And I thought, well, you know, I'm not really a fearful person. I don't know that this message is going to connect that much with my life. But walking out of the service that morning, I was changed forever because of the way that this preacher had talked about not being afraid. I think we don't realize how much fear plays into our daily life, plays into our emotions. Whether we are worried about something, that's fear. When we have anxiety about something, that at its base is fear. I even heard a psychiatrist say that anytime someone is angry, at the root of that emotion, they are reacting to something that they are afraid of. So much of our life is motivated, if we don't pay attention, by fear. Yet the Bible says over and over again, do not be afraid. I also felt like over the last month or so, the email that we read this morning alluded to, there's been a lot of fearful things, both nature and man-made, right? I mean, if you see the news, it just seems to be a chronicle of fear, from Harvey to Irma to Maria, even to this very week, we had a man-made tragedy in Las Vegas. It just seems like we're in a time where fear is rampant. And the Bible says over and over and over again, even when there are very good reasons, it says, do not be afraid. I wonder if you noticed something that I noticed as Irma was on its way. You know, I made a joke that week. I grew up in Texas. I grew up in Tornado Alley. And I made a joke that week that at least a hurricane will give you 3 or 4 days' notice, not like the tornado. It just falls on top of your head. But what I realized that week, that leading up to the hurricane, was I started to see people that were very much on the edge, that were very much kind of had this emotional energy inside. More than once, I saw someone start crying over something that perceived to be a little small and probably wouldn't have elicited that reaction on a normal week. I saw people get angry at the drop of a hat. And it was because this fear and anxiety that preceded our hurricane coming. We were afraid about what was going to happen to our house, afraid what was going to happen to our church, afraid what was going to happen to our very safety. I was locked into the hospital with Caitlin. Caitlin is a nurse at Gulfstream Children's Hospital up in Fort Myers, and she is on the hurricane team. So she got a call, and all the staff on the hurricane team had to report to the hospital and bring their families with them. So I reported to the hospital with her, and they locked us inside. It was very similar to being at the church for 3 days. We kind of had to figure things out. And I was sitting there one of the days before Irma was on her way, talking to one of the guys, another one of the husbands of another nurse, and he was saying that they had just bought, the week before, a brand new house. And it was outside the flood zone, so they weren't carrying flood insurance. But at one point, they said, you know, the surge is going to be 12 feet high. So he was sitting here looking at this hurricane coming, and overnight, he could have completely lost his house, been hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt, and had absolutely nothing to show for it. It's that kind of fear, whether it's medical concerns or financial concerns or social concerns about a relationship, it's that kind of fear that is always present in our lives. So I thought this would be a good time of the year as we enter into fall, as we're coming up on Halloween, we can also have some fun with it and keep it lighthearted, but also talk some about the serious fears in our life and what the Bible has to say about it. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk about this for 3 weeks, and the way I decided to break it down was each week we are going to look at one theological truth from the Bible as to why we do not have to be afraid. Why does the Bible say this over and over and over again? Do not be afraid. Why do we not have to be afraid? Well, that's what we're going to talk about for the next 3 weeks. And each week, we're going to pull out one biblical truth that speaks to why we do not have to be afraid no matter what is coming. So, our big statement for today, our key point is this. You do not have to be afraid because you are not alone. You do not have to be afraid because you are not alone. When I thought about this verse, this statement from the Bible this week, I thought about two different stories. And Les actually reminded me of one last week. He mentioned of Moses and Moses' leadership of the Hebrew people. And I've always thought that Moses was a really kind of tragic character in the Bible. Moses leads these Hebrews out of Egypt, out of slavery, and then they enter into the desert and start making their way to the promised land. The tragic thing about Moses is that Moses begins to age as they make this long journey across the desert. And Moses actually never gets to enter the promised land. Moses, despite leading them out of slavery, getting them on this way, getting them halfway through this journey, he leads them right up to the edge of the promised land. But God tells him, this right here is where your leadership ends. You don't actually get to make it all the way in. So I'm going to read a few verses from Deuteronomy 31, but this is what's going on in the story. This is where we come in. They are right on the cusp of the promised land, and God has said, I'm going to lead the people in. We've got a new leader that's going to lead them into this next chapter. And then Moses brings all the people together, and he says, listen, this is one of my last chances to speak to you. And listen here what Moses' parting words are. He says, Moses then went out and spoke these words to all of Israel. I am now 120 years old, and I am no longer able to lead you. The Lord has said to me, you shall not cross the Jordan. The Lord your God himself will cross over ahead of you. He will destroy these nations before you, and you will take possession of their land. Joshua will also cross over ahead of you. As the Lord said, the Lord will deliver them to you, and you must do to them all that I have commanded you. And here's his last remark, what's most relevant to us today during this series. Moses closes, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. For the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. You see, this is not ultimately about Moses or their transitioning to Joshua. Moses is saying, Joshua's great. He's also, he's going to be a great leader. Moses says, no. He says, don't be afraid. Because even after me, even after Joshua, no matter what it is that comes next, you are not alone. Not only is God with you, but I don't pick the songs when I preach. I kind of tell Tara, hey, this is what we're talking about, whatever you think would fit real well. And as we were singing this morning, the song that Tara picked fits perfectly into our passage. It says, God is not only with you, God is ahead of you. Whatever it is that's around the corner, God's already there. He's waiting on you to get there. It says God will go ahead of you. God will never leave you, never forsake you. You do not have to be afraid because you are not alone. And this does not mean that there won't be hard things, that there won't be struggles. I know that you know that no matter what it is in life, whatever is worth accomplishing comes with difficulty, with sacrifice, with loss. This is not saying, God never says throughout the Bible, if you follow me, things will be easy. It's actually the exact opposite. But God says, but don't worry about that. No matter what complication comes your way next, whether it's medical, whether it's financial, whether it's social. You know, I think on a deep level, I think we kind of associate this with kids. Well, I went to school today, and there's this girl, and I don't think she likes me. I don't think he likes me. I don't know who my friends are going to be. I think that's a universal feeling, right? Even us that are kind of tough and stand on our own, we still care about the people around us. We want to live in community where we feel like we are loved and we love them and they love us back. And I think that's something that we're afraid of. Well, are they talking about me? Or am I not liked at work? And what about this really important relationship to me? No matter what it is that makes us worry, we are not alone. I think one of the things that is difficult about worry, I think when we are stressed and we're anxious and we're kind of imagining this bad thing that could happen, I think one of the things that makes it so difficult is often when we worry or when we imagine something bad happening, we imagine it happening to us by ourselves, right? When we're worried about losing our job, or when we're worried about this thing going wrong or that thing going wrong, we often imagine in our mind us facing that tragedy on our own. And in our worry, we don't realize the people that we're surrounded by that love us. I think that's one of the things that I saw from the hurricane, right? I think just normal people, neighbors, and people that you might not... I talked to my neighbor more in and around the hurricane than I have in the previous 5 months, 6 months that I lived here combined. I think we are supported by a community around us that we often aren't even aware of until trials come. Oftentimes, we're not even aware of the presence of God until a trial comes. And then we feel like we are getting closer to God who's been there all along. So I wonder how this applies to our life. I wonder, you know, when they first come to the promised land and they send in spies, the spies come back and they say, oh man, the people in there are giants. They're huge. We're never going to be able to defeat these people. I wonder what the things are in your life right now that cause you to be anxious, that cause you to worry, that you, at a deeper level, are fearing. Well, the Bible says that no matter what it is, do not be afraid, because you are not alone. It reminded me of one other story in the scripture that I want to share with you. This is from Matthew 28. And the disciples have been with Jesus. Jesus has come. He's taught them how to live. He's actually already been crucified. He's resurrected. He's come back to them. And now he's about to ascend into heaven and go and be with God. And he's about to leave them, or so it feels like, right? It kind of feels like he's not going to be available to them anymore. And Jesus gets them together just like Moses, and he says, listen, I'm about to leave, but let me leave you with these words. And as I was looking at these two stories, it reminded me, I think times of big transition in our lives where we're uncertain about the future are some of the times where it's easiest to be afraid. I think that's some of the easiest times to worry, to get anxious, to stress, to lose sleep, whenever we know a big change is coming and we're not sure what it is going to look like. Well, this is what Jesus says to the disciples as he is about to leave them. He says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And here, just like Moses, pay attention to this last phrase. Jesus says, and surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. Surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. You see, even like the people that are about to storm into the promised land, these disciples have a really long, hard road ahead of them. This in no way says, well, nothing bad is going to happen. I'm going to keep everything okay. You're going to be safe. It's actually quite the opposite. Jesus promised them. He said, if they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. If they hated me, they're going to hate you. He knows he is sending them out as he calls them sheep among wolves. These men are responsible for the gospel spreading all over the world. And history says that most of them paid with their life. But nonetheless, Jesus, who knows these things are coming, says, do not be afraid, because I am going to be with you to the very end of the age. You have nothing to be fearful of. And I think this promise should empower us. I think it should embolden us to take risks, to love people around us, to follow God even when it seems like there will be a sacrifice ahead. You know, as I was thinking about this story over the course of this week, I remembered this scene that I saw play out several years ago when I was camping. I was in Colorado, and I was at Rocky Mountain National Park, and I was in this campground, and this young family showed up and camped a little bit away from me. And I woke up one morning, I was laying in a hammock, and I looked over, and I saw this kid. He was probably a year and a half, 2 years old. You know how men are, the age. He's about this big. I don't know how old he is, but he's probably this big. And he was playing on the top of this tree stump. And this tree stump was probably, I don't know, maybe 3 to 4 times as tall as he was. I mean, it came up to about here on me. And here this little kid is playing around on top of it, running back and forth, laughing, giggling. And I'm thinking, if that kid takes a fall, it's really going to hurt. I mean, I don't know what is 3 times as high as me, maybe 18 feet. Actually, it would be a little bit less. You know, when I was a little kid, I'm just going to be vulnerable with y'all for a second. When I was a little kid, one of my very first prayers that I can remember, one of my very first ones was, God, I just want to grow up and be as tall as my dad. My dad's about 6 foot, so God said no. it'll be a little bit less than 18 feet, but either way, 17, if I took a fall from 17 feet, that would hurt, right? I'd break something. I'm going to the hospital. This kid is playing on a platform 3 times his height, and he's laughing and giggling, he's running all around. Why was he able to do that? He was able to do that because his dad was standing right next to him. Every time the kid would go to one side, the dad would go to the other side. Every time, he would just follow his kid around as his kid was running back and forth, all the way across this stump, 5 feet in the air. He was able to do that because he knew that he was not alone. He was able to function in this environment that seemed perilous to him because he knew that his father was right there no matter what happened. Do not be afraid because you are not alone. I'm thankful that that is true in Scripture. I'm thankful that it is repeated to us over and over and over again. And I'm thankful that it continues to be true for us today. Let's pray. God, we thank you and we praise you that you have promised us that no matter what happens, no matter what comes around the corner, not only will you be there, but you are in fact already there. That you have gone ahead of us, and that we have absolutely nothing to be afraid of. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, we will continue in our worship of the Lord through the giving and receiving of an offering. Well, thank you so much for being here. It was great to have you this morning. I'm excited about the next 2 weeks of this series. This would be an excellent time to invite a friend, a neighbor, a family member. It'd be a great time to bring a friend or a guest. So, and now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance and give you his peace. Amen.